the EEG source imaging we have done, I don't want to keep talking about that. There is a one question is that still it's not ideal. So how could we do better? And ideally is we could develop a single neural imaging technology that can do everything, get high spatial resolution, high temporal resolution. But unfortunately, that's not there yet. So we hope something would come out down the road. Hopefully this Brain Initiative will come out something. But before then, we should address a clinical need. We should help a patient who are suffering by a variety of disorders. So one other approach is something called multimodal neuroimaging. Has been considered by various groups and a scientific community as one of the viable options. That is to combine various different kind of neuroimaging modality and to achieve this high spatial temporal resolution neuroimaging. One particular way is combine functional MRI with electrophysiology. So as this slide is shown, that you can see that we talk about this, and neural activation is going to lead to the neuronal currents flowing over the passive volume conductor of the brain, and which is being picked up by EEG sensor as EEG or by MEG sensor as MEG, so which give us an electrophysiology response. At the same time that we know neural activation through neurovascular coupling is going to lead to both functional MRI activation mapping, which is being well established. So as early as 2001, Loctisis and colleagues actually have done a very influential animal study. In the monkey model, they insert this implanted electrode to the visual cortex, and then they record the electrophysiology response and the bodal response given the visual stimulation to the monkey. Here is a simultaneous recording showing the bodal response and electrophysiology and recording, which illustrate a really very nice correlation between the electrophysiology and the bodal fMRI signals. So based on that, and we can also observe that in the typical, this curve I showed before, this is bodal time curve. You know, the bodal fMRI is a wonderful in the spatial domain, but it's very slow in time. And EEG is wonderful in time, but it's very, on the other hand, is low in space. But if you look at the frequency domain, here is a very interesting plot that showing this EEG, a very broad spectrum, but the bold signal showing very narrow frequency spectrum and showing the activity less than 0.4 and hertz. So how we are going to integrate these two kind of signal obtained based upon different kind of physical principles? That is really one of the big challenges in neuroimaging research, in my opinion. So here is in our group, and we have been tried to address this problem, not in hardware, because there are several hardware out there by various commercial entities. And also fMRI and EEG are all well-established and technology in terms of recording. What we have been doing is after you get the EEG recording, and similarly, you could get an MEG recording, but on the other hand, it has been challenging or has not been shown that one can do simultaneous MEG and fMRI recording. But EEG in this sense has its unique feature that it is possible you can do this EEG and fMRI simultaneously. So once you get these two, how you are going to establish this cross-modal relationship and how to integrate them in a principled way, not just ad hoc way and say I'm just fuse them together. But we need to have some model and have theory to guide such kind of relationship. So my group has and developed a theory and based upon one, it is limited in the sense that we assume it's a linear coupling between the neural currents and the bodal fMRI. And this, so I will show in a minute that it may not work in some case, but if the linear coupling assumption holds, and we did derive a theoretical relationship illustrating that bold effector size, which can be measured at every voxel inside the brain using a fMRI machine, is proportional to the time integration of the power of the source current at the same voxel. So based on this relationship, we have done a series of human experimentation. In this case, it's a 3 Tesla and MRI machine, and we are routinely virtually every day or two, we're performing such kind of EEG and fMRI and simultaneous mapping in University of Minnesota. And here is showing the concept of our approach that, say, we get fMRI activation mapping, we get EEG. So for a given EEG distribution for each time point, and usually we see that we get a spatial map. And one thing is how you are going to solve the inverse problem, do the source imaging for these. So the fMRI activation constraint is being used to guide such kind of inverse mapping from the scalp to the inside the brain. And in that way, we integrate these two together. And this result and show one typical example that by visual stimulation, we get both fMRI, get VEP. And if you just solve the inverse imaging problem from EEG alone, you can see that in 76 milliseconds, the activity starts from V1 and then 112 milliseconds and 212 milliseconds, gradually shifting to the other area of the visual cortex. And our technique actually in this case and show very nicely if you integrate the fMRI and the result becomes much, much better. So now there's one question which remains unclear as what we talk about, that is the linear assumption.